Hey, Marie.
What happened to you?
Oh, I got shot in the head.
What's up, gamers? Welcome back to another episode of Video Game Gems. I'm Ginge the Ripper. Let's play a game. Sonic the Hedgehog 2006 is known as one of the worst Sonic games in existence. The game was rushed, it's full of broken mechanics and glitches, and has a narrative full of holes. It's an overall unpolished mess. So why are we talking about it on Video Game Gems? Sonic 06 was full of potential, set to be the best of the Sonic games and the foundation for the series going forward. This channel was created to teach players the difference between what makes a game good and what makes a game bad. Part of understanding what makes a good game a gem is understanding what keeps a bad game from being a gem. Sonic 06 was Sonic's 15th anniversary game, set to be a rebirth of the series, which is why it was just named Sonic the Hedgehog. The game was based around the Sonic Adventure games. It was going to incorporate everything the games did well and improve on them as the ultimate 3D Sonic experience. During development, Sega made several poor decisions that led to the downfall of Sonic 06. They pushed for a 2006 holiday release, hoping to boost sales for the anniversary, giving Sonic Team a one-year time frame. Most of the Sonic games have released within a year of each other, but because the team was working with new technology, the game was taking longer than expected to develop. Not only was the game far from ready for a holiday release, its completion was estimated to miss the anniversary entirely. Things only got worse from there as Sega wanted a Sonic game on all the new consoles to promote the anniversary. When the team found out that the Nintendo Wii didn't have the processing power of the 360 or the PS3, they realized Sonic 06 couldn't run on the console. To fix this issue, Sega split the team in half. One half continued working on Sonic 06, and the other on an entirely new game for the Wii that would eventually become Sonic and the Secret Rings. To make matters even worse, the series director at the time, Yuji Naka, left the company in the middle of development, so the team was understaffed, with no leader, and had a less than ideal time frame to work with. It's amazing the final product isn't worse. For what it's worth, Sonic 06 isn't unplayable. If you're familiar with 3D Sonic games, you can get through the game with little to no issue. I still find myself replaying the game every now and then despite its flaws. The levels were designed to be larger than past Sonic games. The team wanted players to explore them in different ways, so multiple characters were added to the game. Many people thought this meant that each character would have had their own story like in Sonic Adventure, but we don't know for sure. Sonic Team wanted to create a playable character who would take full advantage of the game's new physics engine. Silver the Hedgehog was created as a result. His psychokinetic powers and color texture were chosen based around this idea. As this was meant to be a rebirth of the series, Blaze the Cat was reworked from a princess from another universe into Silver's future companion. However, there are cutscenes that allude to her remembering who Sonic is, suggesting her role in the story was originally more complex. Almost all the existing cast of the franchise made an appearance in Sonic 06 and were playable to some degree. Metal Sonic was planned to be included in the game and have some importance to the plot, but was scrapped due to time. It's unknown whether more characters were planned for the game other than Metal Sonic, but we were 6 away from having the complete modern cast. Because the game was rushed, most of the characters' mechanics don't work well and they aren't fun to play with. The three protagonists have a little more polish to them, but they still have their flaws. Of all the flaws that befell Sonic 06, the narrative probably suffered the most. The game gave us a basic understanding of the story without going into detail. Some of the levels the characters play through have no significance to the plot. A good example of this can be found in the first level of Sonic's story. Sonic chases after Eggman's battleship trying to rescue Elise. Eggman ends up getting away, so Sonic just runs back to town to figure out where Eggman was going in the first place. Sonic had absolutely no reason to go to Wave Ocean and gained nothing from it. Sonic's story is just a game of shine thief between Sonic and Eggman. Eggman kidnaps Elise, Sonic steals her back, round and round it goes. Sonic's story and Eggman's plan has little to no significance to the overall arcing narrative. Shadow and Silver's stories are more important and go a little more in depth with everything going on in the background. However, there is still a hefty amount of information that is glossed over. Shadow eventually finds out that the humans betray him in the future and force one of his closest allies to seal him away, blaming him for the tragedy that would happen in the near future. But Shadow never seems to care or take a lot of time to reflect on this. Most of the side characters are only around when they're convenient to the plot, and tossed aside when they aren't needed. When Sonic, Tails, and Knuckles make it back to the present and head for the train station, Knuckles and Tails follow Sonic inside but disappear afterward. Once you complete Radical Train, you find out that Tails is still in town as if he never left. The same thing can be said for Blaze and Amy in Silver Story, though Amy kinda gets a pass since she's just there doing her own thing and has no significance to the plot. Shadow's companions, Rouge and Omega, are the only ones who stick by him throughout the game until he decides to run off by himself. Shadow's story feels like it had the most work put into it, and as a result, is more fun to play through than the others. Despite its flaws, Sonic 06 is still my favorite Sonic game, not for what it is, but for what it could have been. So, what did Sonic 06 get right? What made it revolutionary? Other than Eggman, humans have never been a big part of the Sonic series outside of a few games. Canonically, Sonic has always lived on Earth, which is why humans are usually background characters in the games. We all knew as technology advanced, video game characters would become more realistic, so finally getting to see realistic humans in a Sonic game was so exciting. The fanbase has mixed feelings about the realistic looking Eggman in Sonic 06, but I love the design. This was the Eggman I'd always wanted to see since humans were introduced into the series. Because Sonic 06 went in this direction, the Sonic characters also went through a design change. Sonic characters are about half the size of humans, and since the humans were taller than in previous games, the Sonic characters were also taller. Once again, the fanbase has mixed feelings about this, and once again, I think they're all idiots. I love the more realistic looking design choice of the Sonic characters. The design change made the series feel much more mature, which fit well with the game's serious tone. Also, the Sonic characters' mouths are in the middle of their faces, at least on the models, instead of off to the side. I don't know why so many people have a problem with this. Middle-mouthed faces look much more natural and realistic than mouths that are off to the side. Seriously, Sonic Team, make this a permanent change! Eggman's robots were also a reflection of the redesign. Instead of robotic animals or soldiers in his likeness, his robots look more capable and threatening. Speaking of, and this is kind of a personal pet peeve, so take it with a grain of salt. I wish they would redesign Omega. He's meant to be a powerfully strong robot. There's even a part in the game where he subdues Mephiles by himself. While his upper body looks the part, his lower body is underwhelming. He looks top-heavy, like if he fell over, he wouldn't be able to get back up on his own. They gave him thicker legs in Sonic 06, which was a good start, but they need to take his design a step further. Sonic 06 wasn't afraid to tell a dark story. Characters were more emotional, which helped refine their personalities and tell a better story. Their actions had consequences, characters could get hurt or even die. Eggman was also much calmer and more collected, making him a real threat to Sonic. I love the scene where Shadow breaks into Dr. Eggman's train demanding answers about Mephiles. Instead of telling him outright, Eggman gives him a hint and tells him to go find the answer himself, because he knows that is the only way Shadow will understand how to defeat him. The Chaos Emeralds have more depth to them as well. The game explored other abilities the Emeralds could possess and the power each of them were capable of on their own. Just one allowed the user to see another person's thoughts. Two could send you back in time or bind a soul to a vessel. And while the Emeralds played a big role in the game, collecting all seven wasn't the main focus of the narrative, unlike most games in the franchise. Sonic is given a new set of shoes with the power to harness special gems that gave him different abilities. While the gems don't have a history outside of Sonic 06, I always thought of them as this game's version of the Soul Emeralds, since they are similar in design. For those that don't know, remember when I said Blaze was originally a princess from another universe? The Soul Emeralds are her universe's equivalent to the Chaos Emeralds, except the Soul Emeralds are actually shaped like emeralds. I've always liked the idea of the Soul Emeralds being non-canonical and just collectibles that allow you to go supersonic in regular stages after you've collected all seven, and this game was the first step in seeing that idea come to life. There's an unused rainbow gem in the game's files that was shown off in the 2006 E3 trailer that would have allowed Sonic to transform into supersonic in levels. The gem is functional and can be loaded into the game through hacking, but since supersonic was never programmed into the game, all Sonic can do is perform the transformation animation before returning to normal. There are several levels in Sonic's story that have mock speed challenges near the end, where Sonic is always running at top speed. You drop your rings if you run into an object, and die if you fall off the track. These challenges became the beta for the boost mechanic Sonic is known for nowadays. Players didn't like these sections of levels for multiple reasons, the big one being that they were difficult to navigate because of how unpolished the game was, making some of the areas impossible to complete unless you're already familiar with the layout. Sonic was hard to control because of how sensitive his movement was. Sonic could also perform a short or high jump depending on how quickly you pressed the jump button. The Mach Speed challenges were minute-long endurance tests with no checkpoints. If you died, you'd have to start all over from the beginning, and if you got a game over, you'd have to redo the level entirely, and in some cases, recomplete the side quests that are needed to unlock the level to begin with. Unlike everyone else, I loved these and saw potential in them. If Sonic Team had the chance to refine them, the Mach Speed challenges could have made a return. I really wish Shadow and Silver had a few of them in their stories as well. Neither of them are as fast as Sonic, but Shadow could have ridden a bike, and Silver could have flown using his psychokinesis. If Sonic Team ever has the chance to remake this game the way it was originally intended to be created, I could die happy. The soundtrack for Sonic the Hedgehog 2006 is outstanding and still holds up to this day, except for Shadow's theme. I don't want to hear a single one of you say that Sonic 06's remix is better than the original. Several tracks were cut due to time, some of them being other variations of his world. I still think Sonic 06 has the best soundtrack of all the games so far, and would love to see more work from these artists in future titles. Now, we can't talk about Sonic 06 without talking about the relationship between Sonic and Elise. Sonic and Elise develop feelings for each other over the course of their adventure, to the point where she kisses him at the end of the game. At the time, most people thought this was adorable and didn't read too much into it. However, some people claim that Sega was promoting bestiality, and nowadays it's a meme within the Sonic fanbase. Growing up, I too found their relationship to be adorable, and by that I mean I was jealous of Sonic. I believe everyone's hate for this relationship is unjustified. In the comics, Sonic dates a raccoon and everybody is okay with that. Fans try to justify this claim by arguing that the two are similar in design. Which means that they're not mad that Sonic is in love with a human, they're mad that Sonic is in love with a realistic-looking human. So, if Elise looked like this, no one would have a problem with it. Sonic characters look more like humans than animals anyway. That's why it's so easy for fans to redraw them as humans and why no one had a problem with these two smooching until it became a meme. So how do I feel about it now? Honestly, it still doesn't bother me. At the end of the day, they're both fictional characters, so it doesn't matter what kind of relationship they have. However, a relationship is out of character for Sonic. Sonic is a character who prides himself on being as free as the wind, so much so that he just seems like the kind of guy who wouldn't tie himself down. Not only that, but even though the game alludes to a relationship between the characters, up until Elise's kiss with Sonic, every one of their romantic scenes could be interpreted as them becoming closer as friends. If this game was remade, the kiss could be replaced with a hug, and the scene would still capture just as much emotion as the original. The pre-rendered cutscenes are absolutely stunning. Each protagonist has three rendered cutscenes, one during the introduction, halfway point, and ending, and one final cutscene before the final battle. Cutscenes like these would continue to make an appearance in future Sonic games for a time. But since most of Sega's original development team left the company, we don't see them anymore. The pre-rendered cutscenes we see nowadays have dropped in quality. It really puts into perspective the kind of team Sega took for granted, and it's unfortunate. Sonic the Hedgehog 2006 was the best the franchise had to offer, and could have set the foundation for a much more mature and fun franchise. It's unlikely, but maybe one day this game will get a remake, or another game similar to this will arise. But until then, we can only wonder where the Sonic series would be today if this game was a gem. Before we end the video, there's one final thing we need to talk about. One very important character that makes this mess of a game worth replaying over and over again. Iblis Trigger Meat Guy!
Oh, I got shot in the head. You can't laugh.
I can't help it. You over here like I got shot in the head.